Hello and welcome to the first video in a new playlist. This playlist is all about a field of study that loosely you could call, one could call, I could call, I am calling evolutionary computing. And I want to talk about something that's called a genetic algorithm. I want to talk about why genetic algorithms exist, what they are traditionally used for, how you might apply them in different creative contexts, and go through a whole set of examples. So by the end of this, there'll probably be four or five videos showing you a range of examples and ideas of things you can try, as well as code that you can do in both Java using the processing framework and JavaScript using the P5.js framework. So that's my goal. That's what's happening. If you are interested in that, keep watching. If not, go and to a dance party. Okay, never mind. Sorry, I have a new soundboard. It's too exciting. Okay, so all of the stuff that you'll be watching, if you continue to watch, is based on material that is in a book called The Nature of Code. that I guess this is a book. I wrote this book, so that's why I'm using it. If that makes sense. And chapter 9 is the relevant chapter. So if you prefer to read text rather than listen to me yammer on, you can go to this URL and check out this chapter. I'm going to kind of talk you through now. The field of evolutionary computing really dates back, you know, I would say to the 1950s. John Holland, working on different models of simulations of evolution in software. And so there's this problem that comes up in computer science problems and problems in life in general a lot, which is I need to find the answer. A single tiny little optimized perfect example in a sea of so many possibilities. It just would be completely impossible to check every single possibility until I find the answer. Now, that might seem a little abstract. What I want to do is talk about, since I'm here, what I want to do is talk about this traditional genetic algorithms that was designed to solve those kinds of problems. So this is like a slideshow that's automatically playing. But over the course of this video series, I'm going to look at sort of three different scenarios. First, this traditional genetic algorithm that I'm calling it traditional, but it's kind of the original, the classic genetic algorithm. And then some creative twists on this algorithm, looking at this technique called interactive selection, which allows users and audience to kind of help participate in this evolutionary process. An ecosystem simulation to think of using genetics as applied to agents that are moving around the screen and experiencing the sort of artificial world. The video game Spore is quite famous for kind of having stuff like this built into it. So, but this traditional genetic algorithm, a good way to think about why this problem is necessary and how, and why this algorithm is necessary and how this algorithm can be applied is the Shakespearean monkey problem. So the Shakespearean monkey problem is this thought experiment that says, if you had a monkey typing at a typewriter for an infinite amount of time, typing randomly, eventually this monkey would randomly, by typing kind of every random possibility, type out the complete works of William Shakespeare. So while I think we could kind of probably agree that this abstractly as a concept is true, let's think about what this really means. So let's say there's a monkey, this monkey here, and this monkey, let's actually just say there's not actually a monkey. I don't have a monkey to bring in or anything like that. That would be interesting, though. I could try that in another video. But let's say there's a computer simulation of a monkey, okay? And I'm going to say that, let's simplify the problem and say that the only thing we care about is the phrase, to be or not to be, that is the question. Now, that phrase has 39 characters in it. And let's say we have a simplified keyboard. I have a keyboard right here, which has a lot of keys and numbers and punctuation marks. Let's just say we have a simplified keyboard. And this keyboard has only 26 letters, lowercase, A through Z, and it has the space bar. That's 27 letters in total. So if you know about probability, I don't have a coin, but right, if you have a coin has a heads or a tails, you have a 1 out of 2 chance. There's one possibility being the heads, there's 2 possibilities in total. Typing at a keyboard, we can sort of say the same thing. If there's 27 keys, I have a 1 out of 27 chance of typing the T. Now, event probability, if you want to string two events together, if I have a 1 out of 2 chance of flipping heads and then a 1 out of 2 chance of flipping heads, I have a chance of flipping heads twice in a row, 1 divided by 2 times 1 divided by 2. So 1 out of 4 times, right? And you could think about that because I could type, I could flip, and here are my possibilities. Heads, heads, tails, heads, tails. There are 4 ways that I could flip a coin twice, only one of those is heads head. One out of four, or one out of two times one out of two. So the same problem here, the chance that I have for typing a T and then an O is one out of 27 times one out of 27. Okay. So that's, even that is kind of like a very low probability. If I'm just typing at a keyboard randomly, it's quite rare that I'm going to type a T and an O. But it would happen probably in a day of me doing this over and over and over again. Now, the phrase to be or not to be, that is the question, has 39 characters in it. So in order for me to have the probability of typing a T, then an O, then a space, then a B, then an E, then a space, then an O, then an R, then a space, then an N, then an O, then a T. That's another song for somebody to compose. A T, then an O, then a B. Oh, no, space. A T, then an O, then a space, then a B. This is now the probability is 1 divided by 27 to the 39th power. That's 1 divided by 27 times 1 divided by 27 times 1 divided by 39 times. Now, I previously, not right now or this morning, like a while ago, so hopefully this math is right, I did this math. And the actual answer is a 1 in 66, blah, 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 blah. It's a really massively, like, big, unfathomable number. So basically, this thought experiment is, we were talking about genetic algorithms, right? So why is this relevant? This is like an artificial, this is a completely trivial problem, right? Because I'm gonna open up my processing code, I'm gonna make a new sketch, and I'm gonna say print line to be or not to be. I have to say that is the question. That is the question. So look at that. I have now just solved this problem of typing to be or not to be with one line of code. Dun dun dun. I don't have a sound effect for dun 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 yet, so I have to make it. Right? To be or not to be, that is the question. One line of code. But this can serve as an example problem, right? We know the answer. I know the answer is to be or not to be. There are 66 gazillion, zillion, zillion, gazillion possible random phrases, only one of which is the answer. I happen to know the answer, so I could just spit out the answer. But what if there's a problem that the search space is so vast that you couldn't possibly, and you don't know the answer, and you can't check every possibility? This is what a genetic algorithm is for. And I'm going to demonstrate this to you in a couple different ways in a moment. So let's go back, though, to this particular slide and just look at a little bit more about these numbers. So one thing that I did, let's say you have a computer simulation that is typing one, just to think about like really how the sheer vastness of this solution space. Let's say you have a computer simulation that can type 1 million random phrases per second. I don't even know if I can do that, if processing would run that fast. Probably could, but whatever. The point is, if I ran that, it would take, for me to have a 99% probability of at least that phrase coming up once, I would have to run that simulation for this many years. 9.719 gazillion, bazillion, gazillion, blah, 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 blah years. Notice, by the way, that the age of the known universe is this number down here. This number is a lot bigger than that. So these numbers are so incredibly sort of mind-blowingly huge that this, again, the reason that I'm here right now is to talk about genetic algorithms, and this problem is a good way for us to look at, okay, what is an algorithm that could even solve this problem without it taking this much time? And a genetic algorithm is that problem. Now, let's think about this more practically. One example that I love that's on the internet somewhere that I'm gonna just pull up for you right now is called BoxCar 2D. I'm gonna Google BoxCar 2D, and I'm going to run this right now, and I'm gonna let this run for a while. So I think this is a nice demo. Ooh, come on, really? You're going to be so slow? Oh, you know what, I wonder if this page or this page, I'm gonna close a few things just for a second. Refresh this page. Oh, I lost it. Refresh this page. Okay, so this is BoxCar 2D. I did not make this. I don't know why it's running so slow, but now it seems to be doing a little bit better. You could think about, here's the problem. I want to design a car. And I could say that, oh, I know. So let's say I'm a car designer and I know, I'm going to design a car. I want it to be aerodynamic, so it should look like this. I want it to have, you know, small wheels in the front and big wheels in the back. And because I like rainbows, I want it to have a sign, you know, with a rainbow on it. And I also like unicorns, so I want it to have like a unicorn thing at the front, but I have no artistic talent, but this is the best I could do. And I've designed this car. This is like me designing a car. But here, let's think about the possible ways. Let's say I could design a car out of, here are my things, any polygon. I could design a car out of any number of wheels. Those wheels could be attached to the polygon any number of ways, and I could have any mythological creature. I don't think this part is in Box 2D. Mythological creatures. Somebody make a Boxcar 2D with mythological creatures like unicorns. That'll be exciting. So you can see, like, if we started working this out, I probably would also have gazillions and gazillions and gazillions of possible car designs. So one way of finding an optimized car design is to evolve that optimized car design. And if I come back over here and press my button, you can see that's what Boxcar 2D is doing. It's testing out a whole lot of different possible car designs. It's using the Box2D physics engine. I do have some video tutorials about that. So this is ultimately what I'm building to. How can you design a system that uses evolutionary algorithm to evolve a behavior or a design or solve some particular kind of search problem? And there are lots of ways you can apply genetic algorithms. And what I'm going to do in this tutorial series is start with a simple problem with a known answer. And if we can get the genetic algorithm to solve this simple problem with a known answer, then we can take that genetic algorithm and start to apply it to lots of other interesting scenarios without known answers. And the simple problem with a known answer that I want to solve is this one. To be or not to be, that is the question, without a brute force search. So I could make a brute force search that just tries every possible or I could create an evolutionary search, a genetic algorithm search, and that's what I'm going to do. And in that, and that will cover the sort of traditional genetic algorithm. What are the pieces of the algorithm? How does it work? And how do you implement that in code? So this video is my brief sort of overview of kind of covering where the stuff is coming from, what I'm thinking about. And in the next video, what I'm going to do is actually start talking you through the algorithm itself and starting to write pieces of code that implement that algorithm and show it to you in the context of the Shakespeare to be or not to be, that is the question example. Okay? Thanks for watching, and maybe I'll see you in the next video. I don't actually see anybody, and if you're watching this in a video, I'm just recorded, so I'm not actually even a thing, but I am a real person, and you could say hi to me sometime if you wanted to, somewhere. I don't know where. Okay, bye.